Close your eyes, my love. Listen to that angelic music and let it soothe your torment.
I shall come back soon. I shall come back cured. The music's gone. My music's silenced. I must end now.
Towards the end of his life, Robert Schumann composed 5 romances for cello, which his wife Clara destroyed before they could be published. I'm Steven Isserlis, a cellist, and Schumann is a great hero of mine. I'm on my way to Germany to find out what happened to Robert and Clara in those last years, and why Schumann's devoted wife turned against his late music.
20, 40, 60, 80, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 680 Deutsche Mark, sir. Thank you.
Saint Clara.
Well, it's typical that Clara, rather than Robert Schumann, should be on the 100 Deutschmark note. Legend has it that she was the saint who Schumann met when she was a young girl. And again, legend goes on to say they had this idyllic marriage until he cracked up and was taken to the asylum. But I've always wondered how true that is and how idyllic their marriage was, and indeed how much of a saint she was.
My first stop is Bonn, where Schumann spent the last 2 years before his death in 1856, and where he penned his final musical fragments.
Here I am at the Alter Friedhof Cemetery, where Robert and Clara Schumann are buried. And I've always read about this place, but I've never seen it, so finally I get to come here. And the reason I'm here today is that it's the centenary of Clara's death. And so lots of Clara experts and I are going to cluster around the grave and break into a rousing chorus of Happy Death Day to you. Amazing to think that the skeletons are down there, and a monument erected while Clara was still very much around, which must have been quite an occasion, and a portrait of Schumann with his lips pursed, as they so often were, and then Schumann's muse looking up at him, which must have been great inspiration for Schumann. It seems to me that the whole story of Robert and Clara is like the embodiment of romanticism.
Yes, I think it is. It's a very romantic story, beginning when she was a child and he came to Leipzig to study piano with her father. He lived with the family for almost a year, and when he left, they still saw each other almost daily. So this relationship began when she was, well, maybe 11 or 12.
Tonight, Clara was truly inspired and performed my piano sonata like a master. The entire audience was enchanted, and my spirit soared to hear her breathe life into this solitary outcry from my heart.
She became his hand, since he himself wasn't a concert pianist. She was the person who brought his works to life and performed them. She gave the premieres of all his works. So it was a true partnership.
You would say, certainly, she was a great woman. In what ways was she a great woman?
Well, to begin with, she was extraordinarily talented as a pianist and as a composer. Her compositions were generally forgotten. They're being recorded now, performed, new editions of her music are appearing. She was a very gifted composer. I wouldn't say she was a composer of the very first rank, but that she was extremely talented and had the respect of all her contemporaries, Chopin, Mendelssohn, Liszt, and Robert Schumann, too.
This is my constant travelling companion, but in the 19th century, Clara also needed a travelling companion, because it would have been unthinkable for a woman to tour by herself. So Schumann was dragooned into travelling with her after they got married, and this was generally a disaster, because he suffered from severe travel anxiety, and then he was treated very badly, usually. He was an appendage to Clara, the great virtuoso. And he was a homebody, unlike her. She was a real career woman, always wanting to give concerts and earn money. He wanted to be at home with his comforts and his children. He did miss them. But I suppose the worst thing of all was that he just could not compose when they were travelling together. So his life basically ground to a halt. And this was a cause of serious tension between them.
One of the greatest works of Schumann's last years is the Cello Concerto, composed in 1850. While here in Germany, I'm rehearsing for a new recording of the concerto with conductor Christoph Eschenbach, another passionate fan of Schumann's late music.
Thank you. Basses, don't be late with your entrance there when you come in. He comes very sudden with a paw, which I love very much because it's really the break of the mood. You know?
Yeah, maybe not too much on the beat, I hear. So that.
Yeah,
it's presumably right. The off beat.
Right.
Stressed.
Around the beat.
Even when there's seven of them.
Yeah. Do it around the beat. What's more?
They faced many difficulties after their marriage. She was a pianist, he was a composer. She made much more money as a pianist than he did as a composer. And so there were all these difficulties in a dual career marriage. But at that time, of course, Clara and the rest of the world believed that the man and the composer should have priority. And so if the piano was available, he used the piano and Clara had to wait.
It's got to work. It's got to help. At least anything's better than the knife. God, why did you do this to me? Me, of all people. Music is so complete and alive in me that I ought to be able to exhale it like a whispered breath. Now I can scarcely play and one finger stumbles over the other.
He said that he injured the fourth and the third fingers of the right hand. And people have made a lot about the illness. They've tried to connect it with all sorts of organic diseases. But the illness was probably just a tendon strain, a severe tendon strain, and he probably exaggerated the illness for reasons of secondary gain, as we say, and he petitioned for leave of absence from the army because of the injury to his hand. It also stopped him competing with his wife, Clara, who was a very eminent virtuoso, probably a greater pianist than he was.
Last night, the most terrifying thought that a person can ever have occurred to me. The most terrifying with which heaven can punish you. It overwhelmed me so violently that all consolation and every prayer became as ineffective as scorn and mockery. The anxiety drove me from place to place. My breathing was disrupted by one idea. What would happen if you could no longer think? What would happen if you lost your mind?
Dusseldorf as music director. He was worried though. Before he got here, he wrote asking if it was not true that there was a lunatic asylum in the town. He thought that might depress him. Also, when he got here, it turned out he really was not suited to be a conductor or music director. He wasn't an administrator. He wasn't good at telling people what to do. And it was here that things started to go seriously wrong for him.
Initially, his engagement as a conductor was successful, and towards the end he was becoming under increasing pressure. I think he started to experience panic attacks and phobic attacks when he conducted, and the difficulties he had, I think, due to a psychological phenomenon called derealization, where the patient feels that he's outside himself and that the world feels unreal around him, and he was basically trying to fight to control the orchestra and to keep in control of his own feelings.
Most of the books you read today, when they mention the cello concerto, say, of course, this is a product of Schumann's failing years. I mean, how can people say such a thing?
That's total idiocy. I think the craftsmanship of late Schumann is incredible, because it is, he has separated himself from the earlier work and is kind of visionary.
Yes.
And writes the most consciously, and not by mistake, consciously the most daring harmonical things.
Would you say this was a harmonically daring piece?
It is, when it comes later into the development section. There are very certain changes also, not only harmonically, but he cuts a mood like in modern filmmaking.
Yes.
Yeah, it really, like film cuts. And the interesting thing is that the nervousness, the agitato, the anxiety, you can call it, is met after two measures with cello playing again and searching his theme again.